network. Home run cables are installed from outlet locations where data network access is desired back to the distribution center. Computer and peripheral devices simply plug into data outlets to connect to the network. Ethernet uses two of the four pairs in the cable. The green pair connected to pins 1 and 2 for transmitting, and the orange pair on pins 3 and 6 for receiving. Per TIA 570A, data outlets are also 8-pin modular jacks wired to the T568A configuration. Data lines are typically terminated on a data cable termination module such as this. The module allows selected lines to be jumpered to Ethernet support equipment, such as hubs or switches. The distribution center also houses the necessary Ethernet support equipment for the network. We'll take a closer look at the most common devices, including hubs, switches, bridges, and routers. Let's start with the simplest network device, a hub. A hub is like a network outlet strip. It connects together a small number of devices, typically 4 to 6. Data that arrives on any port is simply retransmitted to all other connected devices. Hubs can be connected together or to switches to expand the network, but at 100 base T, the limit is one additional link, or two hubs or switches, between any two devices. The most common use for adding a hub is to connect several devices in a room to one data jack, such as in a home office. When connecting a network component, such as a switch or a hub, to an attached device, such as a PC, a straight-through cable is used. The I/O pins on the hub device are reversed from that of the PC. But when a network component is connected to another network component, such as a hub to a hub, a crossover cable should be used. It reverses pins 1 and 2 and 3 and 6. A switch is similar to a hub, but relies on the frame MAC address to route the incoming frame to the port that's connected to the destination MAC address. Now, this will isolate traffic between two devices at a time, allowing the switch to support several simultaneous data transfers. Switches are intended for larger networks and typically support 8 to 32 attached devices. A bridge is a device which connects two networks together, typically networks which use a similar protocol but different media. Now, the most common bridge used in a home network connects wired Ethernet with wireless Ethernet, 802.11. And the most common version of this bridge is referred to as a wireless access point, WAP, because it allows wireless network devices, such as a laptop computer, to access the wired network. 802.11 bridges come in three flavors. 802.11b devices operate in the 2.4 GHz band at a maximum of 11 megabits per second. 802.11g devices operate in the same band, but at a maximum rate of 54 megabits per second. And 802.11a devices operate in the 5.1 GHz band, also at a maximum 54 megabits per second. The range of 2.4 GHz devices is typically 100 feet in average home construction, while 5.1 GHz signals are highly absorbed by building materials, limiting their range to 25 to 50 feet. Now, since 802.11g devices are backwards compatible with B devices, and given their better range, B and G devices are the best choice for residential installations. They should be installed in a central, high location in the house to give the best signal coverage. The height avoids absorption from furniture and fixtures. In larger homes, multiple access points can be installed in different areas of the home or on different floors. The 2.4 GHz band is divided into 11 channels. Each channel is 22 MHz wide with a 5 MHz offset from the next channel. A wireless access point can be assigned to any one channel. Now, this allows up to three access points to operate in the same location without overlap interference. We'll talk more about access point installation and placement in part 2. A router's job is to selectively route packets, the payload portion of the Ethernet frame, between two different networks. In our case, that means the LAN in the home to the Internet. Now, this is usually a two-step hop from the router through the cable or DSL modem that we'll talk about shortly. If a packet's destination is someplace other than the home network, the originating device will send the frame to the router. The router substitutes the public IP address assigned to the home account by the access provider as the new from address and sends it on its way via the gateway. Likewise, when a router receives a packet from the internet via the gateway, it examines the packet to determine if it's a response to a request originated by a device in the home. If it is, it substitutes that device's IP and MAC address and sends it on its way. If it's not, the packet is discarded. Nearly all routers intended for the home or small office have a 4-to-8-port switch built in. Now, unfortunately, unless you're installing a very small home, you'll still need an additional switch, since you'll typically need to support at least 16 data outlets and devices. A gateway is the interface between two dissimilar networks. It performs protocol conversion as well as providing the physical interface between the Internet Access Provider's network and the home network. Typical gateways include cable and DSL modems that convert the broadband access provider's analog signals to Ethernet 10BASE-T frames for the router. The network router, switch, and gateway are typically installed in the structured cabling system enclosure, since that's the home run location of the TP data network cabling as well as the cabling to the NIDs. The gateway will typically have to be installed on a shelf, bracket, or cable tied to the inside of the enclosure. Another interesting gateway example is this telephone voice line to IP gateway. Now, this device will digitize analog voice signals into IP packets. It can provide two standard voice grade lines with separate phone numbers using a voice over IP service provider. It's easily installed in the distribution center enclosure. One or two voice lines are wired directly to the voice network in place of or in addition to the lines from the traditional telephone NID. Its Ethernet port is wired directly to the switch. Increasingly, it's not just computers that are networked and connected to the internet. Other types of devices are being connected as well, such as internet radios, cameras, music and video servers, even appliances like refrigerators and microwave ovens. But since there's no common control language to communicate with non-computer devices on an Ethernet-based network, manufacturers are incorporating web servers built right into their products and communicate information using an HTML data format. This network-connected camera is a good example. The camera site at the camera IP address, accessible from any web browser, has several pages used to control the camera setup and operation. This is also how network devices are configured, including routers and bridges. It's also important to understand that Ethernet uses what's referred to as a carrier-sense multiple access protocol. A device gains access to the network and to another device on a first-come, first-served basis. And because data is not sent as a continuous stream, but a series of short frames, other devices can compete for and gain access to the network in between frames, interrupting data transfer. Therefore, the delivery time of data is indeterminate. Now, this is fine if you want to send a file to a printer, but it may not be the best protocol for streaming audio and video. Other protocols, such as IEEE 1394, also referred to as FireWire, may be a better audio and video application protocol. We'll be installing a wide range of network products in our project house. We'll cover the planning and installation issues of data networks in more detail in Part 2 and 3. Next, we need to cover the basics of broadband RF distribution in and to the home, including external sources such as satellite, cable, and off-air signals. The distribution of internal sources such as DVD players, modulated AV sources, and cameras, coax cable types and characteristics, direct broadcast satellite systems, and off-air antenna systems. A broadband RF network must support the distribution of external sources, such as cable service signals, off-air signals, and satellite signals. It must also support the distribution of in-home generated sources, such as VCRs, DVDs, and other entertainment program sources, cameras, and computer-generated media. Let's start with an overview of each external source, starting with traditional cable service. The cable television industry uses a standard channelized frequency allocation on their distribution system. Downstream channels start at channel 2 and go up beyond channel 125. You've got a copy of this table in your workbook, so look at it. The table gives